Welcome to Higher Order Derivatives. The goals of this video will be to find the derivatives of higher order, and given a distance function, find the velocity and acceleration function. This video ran long, so this is actually part one of two on higher order derivatives. So far in class, we've been finding a variety of derivatives. For example, if we have the function f of x is equal to 3x to the fourth minus 2x squared minus 9, we can apply the power rule to obtain the derivative equal to 12x cubed minus 4x. F prime of x is the first derivative of f of x. However, we can find the second, third, and fourth derivative as follows. If we take the derivative of the derivative, we'll obtain the second derivative. And if we take the derivative of the second derivative, we'll obtain the third derivative, and so on. So for example, using the derivative from above, if we want to find the second derivative, we simply have to find the derivative of the derivative, which would give us 36x squared minus 4, again using the power rule. There's a variety of notation used for higher order derivatives. This first row represents the first derivative, second row would be the second derivative, and so on. You may want to pause the video here and take a look at all the different notations that can be used. So what is the point of finding higher order derivatives? Remember, the derivative measures the rate of change of y with respect to x. It also finds the slope of a tangent line at a given value of x. The second derivative measures the rate of change of the first derivative with respect to x. It also finds the rate of change of the slope of a tangent line at a given value of x. So again, what would this be useful for? If you have a position function s of t that measures the distance traveled in miles with respect to time in hours, the first derivative would measure the instantaneous rate of change of distance with respect to time. Well, when you measure the change in distance with respect to the change in time, you get velocity. In this case, it would be in miles per hour. The second derivative measures the instantaneous rate of change of speed or velocity with respect to time. When you measure the change of velocity with respect to time, you get acceleration. And obviously, measuring velocity and acceleration can be very useful. So to summarize, the velocity function is equal to the first derivative of the position function, and the acceleration function is equal to the first derivative of the velocity function, which is also equal to the second derivative of the position function. Now, I should mention that in math, the words speed and velocity are often used interchangeably. However, in physics and engineering, this is not done because velocity requires direction, while speed does not. Okay, let's take a look at an example. At time t equals 0, a diver jumps from a platform diving board 32 feet above the water. The position of the diver is given by the function s of t is equal to negative 16t squared plus 16t plus 32. We want to find the following. Find the time when the diver hits the water. Find the average velocity from t equals 0 to t equals 2. Find the velocity at impact, and find the acceleration at t equals 2. Now, some of these are algebra questions and some of them are calculus questions. Let's take a look at the first one. Find the time when the diver hits the water. Well, s of t is the height from the ground and t is time. So if we want to know when the diver hits the water, that's when the height from the water would be 0. We need to set s of t equal to 0 and solve. So let's see if we can factor this. So we obtain two values of t, t equals 2 and t equals negative 1. Right away, we know that time can never be negative, so this is not applicable in this situation. So it looks like the diver hits the water after 2 seconds. Part B, find the average velocity from t equals 0 to t equals 2. Well, since t equals 0 represents when he jumps, t equals 2 represents when he hits the water, we're finding the average speed for the entire dive. If you remember from before, average velocity represents the slope of a secant line. So this is not a calculus question. So we need to find the two points when t equals 0 and t equals 2. So s of 0, subbing a 0 into our function, we can see we're going to have 0 plus 0 plus 32. So the first point we're going to use would be 0, 32. Again, that should make sense because the starting height was 32. S of 2, we just figured out that after 2 seconds, the diver hits the water, so S of 2 is going to equal 0. So the 2 points we're going to use to find the slope, which represents the average velocity, will be these 2. So y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. Negative 16 feet per second. Remember that our height was measured in feet and our time was in seconds. The reason it's negative is because our velocity is downward. Okay, so now I want to find the velocity at impact. Remember that the velocity function is equal to the derivative of the position function. So we need to find the derivative of this, which would be negative 32t, applying the power rule, plus 16, plus 0. So we need to evaluate the velocity function at the value of t at impact. Remember that we found before that it took the diver 2 seconds to hit the water, so the time is 2 seconds at impact. Looks like we're going to get negative 48 feet per second. Now remember that our average velocity was just negative 16 feet per second, but you can see at impact the diver was traveling 3 times the average velocity. This has a lot more meaning. We can find the velocity at any instant in time between 0 and 2 seconds if we wish. Now if we want to find the acceleration at t equals 2, remember that the acceleration function is equal to the derivative of the velocity function, or the second derivative of the position function. But we already have the velocity function, so let's go ahead and find the derivative of that. Here's our velocity function. So the derivative of this would be negative 32. So the acceleration function is a constant, which again hopefully makes sense. That's actually the acceleration due to gravity on Earth. So we would expect this to be a constant. So the acceleration for the entire dive is negative 32 feet per second. Again, the reason it's negative is the acceleration due to gravity is downward, which holds us in place on Earth.